Hey folks, so today I am going to do a video on decals, detail painting, and chipping. I'm hoping I'm going to be able to get all that in a single video. That's my plan anyway. So I'm going to basically demonstrate all three of those things in, I guess, not a summary form, but in a form that's I guess concise enough that I can get it in under an hour, which means I'm going to try and jabber on as little as possible. So the first thing is, there's a great debate and discontent and argument and blah 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 about the pronunciation of the word decal. You can pronounce it whatever way you want to pronounce it because it's based on your dialect. So decal, decal, whatever is fine. But they're both correct, by the way. So it doesn't really make any difference which way you feel is right. Both of them are. So decal, decal. I actually mix it up, so it doesn't really make any difference to me what you call them. So whatever your dialect dictates, that's what you use. So there you go. The other big thing is whether or not you should use a gloss varnish before you put your decals on. There's a big stink. There was anyway. I don't know if it's still going on because I don't pay any attention to that shit anymore. About whether or not you should use a gloss varnish to do it. I honestly don't give a shit what people's opinion is on that. Nor do I really give a shit about the people's opinion about decal either. So if you have one, I don't really care to hear about it. What I'm going to do in this video is I'm going to demonstrate what I do for all of the things that I'm doing. And if you want to do something differently or you have a different thing to do, go ahead and fill your boots. It has no bearing on what I'm doing. Now, when it comes to the gloss, like I had just mentioned, there is a, I'm going to call it a dialogue, but it's not, because I'm just trying to be polite, maybe, about whether or not you should use it. There are people that think that it's unnecessary. Now, my opinion on using a gloss before you put decals on is you want to take the steps necessary so you have the best chance of success. So you should do those things. Using a gloss creates an extremely smooth, not perfectly smooth, but a smooth, uniform surface in comparison to a painted surface that has several types of paint or brands of paint or textures of paint, whether it be gloss, a matte, or a semi-gloss paint. So if you coat it with a gloss coat, it removes all of those things, all those variables, and reduces them to just a single variable that is easier to control. So it increases your best chance of success. So that's why I do it. I'm not interested in arguments or dialogue or debate about the issue because I don't really care. It's what I do because I have 20 years of success using that method, and I'm going to continue using it because of the 20 years of success I have using that method, along with everything else I'm just about to talk about. The other thing I will do is I will use warm water to soak my decals in before I apply them because it reduces the decal from the paper that it's mounted on. If you notice here, the paper, this blue paper, has a decal attached to it. It's basically, this is a piece of paper with a very thin skin of plastic, and on the inside of the plastic, the decal is painted on there. So you want to release that decal from the paper. So you cut the decal free from the blue, from this large card, so it's a small decal. You soak it in your warm water and it releases. You don't want it to come off the paper, you just want it to be loose so you can slide it around. And then once it's released, the warm water actually does it faster than cold water. So that's one of the reasons you use warm water. The other reason is warm water tends to make the decals softer. It makes it a little tiny bit more, it gives it a better compliance for surfaces with irregular details, like Zimmerit. Zimmerit being one of the most difficult things to add decals to. I have had 100% success with adding decals, including Tamiya decals, which are one of the most difficult ones to use because they're so thick, and adding it to Zimmerit. It's actually not that difficult to do if you do it. When I do use the method I'm about to use, when I use that, I don't have any problems. It just works out, and it ends up looking like paint when it's done. So warm water, use a gloss surface, and use a good quality setting solution. This is what I use. Now, this is pretty easy to get in North America, not so easy to get in Europe. I'm not recommending that everybody gets this stuff here. I just use it because it's what I've been using for 20 years. I think it's 20 years now. This is my third bottle, and each bottle lasts me about 5 years, so I'm probably over 15 years now. So I'm probably closer to 20 now, getting up there, because this one's almost empty. And it's about time for me to order one. When I first started to order them, they were $2 a bottle, then they went up to $5.99, and now they're, this one was $10.99, and that was about 5 years ago. A little over 5 years now, I think. Just about 5 years. So, yeah, they seem to go up quite a lot. I don't know what they are now because I haven't bought one in a while. I do know that when I go to buy one, I can't get it from the place I used to get it because they're out of business. They're just gone. So, but I can still get this, and I don't have any problem because I looked to see where I can get it from, and Sunward Hobbies, actually, is where I was going to get it from. It's in Toronto. Actually, I don't know if it's in Toronto. It's in Ontario, I know that. So Walther Salvaset is what I use. It's for railroads is what they use where it comes from because it's Walther's. And it's probably medium to strong strength, which is why I use it. I've never had a destroyed decal. It's never happened. When decals get destroyed, they get destroyed in the water. They don't get destroyed by this. And it's usually because the decal is extremely old and it just shatters. Or it's just poor quality. But I've never had that destroyed decal. So, warm water, gloss surface, good setting solution, cotton bud, one of these, or Q-tip, whatever you want to call it, cotton bud, and a cocktail stick, or toothpick, whatever you want to call it. These are essential to my successful decal application. So without those, I wouldn't have any luck. I'm pretty sure of it, actually. So the first thing that I do is I add gloss paint to the surface. I just need a brush that will be the right size. This one will do. Don't need a big one. So the subjects that I'm going to be putting decals on are, there are no decals that go on the Ferragostal, which is the ammunition transport vehicle for the Carl, this thing here. It doesn't have any decals, so I can't use that. But I can use the platform wagon, and I can use the Volkswagen Beetle. Both of them have decals, and I'm pretty sure I broke the handle off that damn shovel again, even though I just glued it back on. I can see it. It's broken right there. So I'm going to try and find that. It's in here somewhere. When I reached over like that, I touched it with my finger, and it went ping! It's here somewhere. I heard it land, but I don't know where it is. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to add gloss to just the areas where the decals are going to go. So you need the thing that you are using for references for adding the decals so you know where they're going to go. Now this has only been base painted. So it's base colors on there. That's why it's very toy-like looking right now. And base colors on here. This is my gloss paint of choice. This is what I've been using for, I think it's about 10 years now. I've been using this. It's Alclad's Aqua Gloss. The reason I use it is because it so far has been 100% failure proof. It has never failed me. It's an acrylic, which means it doesn't have a smell for me anyway, and that's good. The other thing that I like about this is I have never had any material that I use for weathering or painting or even a thinner break it down yet. To a point where it fails. So if I'm doing weathering using an acrylic based thinner, this seems to put up with it without breaking down quite successfully. It's damn near bulletproof. It's almost indestructible, which is something you have to keep in mind when you're using it in your airbrush. When you're done using your airbrush, you got to make sure you clean that airbrush really, really well, because this stuff is really hard to get out if you've missed a spot. So always make sure you clean your airbrush really well after using this stuff. Very important, because it will gum up your airbrush really nicely if you forget. It's like a hard, transparent plastic, so it's very difficult to see. So the first thing I do is I use a brush to brush on, and I use the brush for this stuff because it's got a really good self-leveling. As long as you don't soak the area, don't worry about the bubbles. The bubbles just disappear on their own, unless you go crazy and you allow like huge numbers of bubbles. So I try to minimize them a little bit, but when it comes to gloss, bubbles are kind of sort of part of the package when you're brushing it on. It's just how it works. There are lots of people that like using the floor polish future for doing this. I used to use it until I had it destroy too many of my models. I no longer trust future floor polish on my models. I will use it, however, now and again on diorama stuff, but I will not ever use future floor polish on a diorama again. It'll never happen. It's just never ever gonna, I don't trust it anymore. It destroyed two models while I was working on them by creating this weird like a haze, like with salty tide marks. It looks like there was salt water got on the model, some kind of contamination in the bottle. It was a brand new bottle, and it had never been used before, and I used it on a model, and it just completely ruined the paint job. So I had to strip the paint and start all over again. That was an enormous amount of work. I was very pissed off at it. So, but because of that, I never used the floor polish on a model ever again. If you want to use floor polish on your models, go ahead if you want to do that. Just keep in mind, the future floor polish is not a modeling material. It was never tested for that. It was never designed for that. The material science was never done for what you do with materials, like washes, thinners, any other chemicals that you add. It's never been done. So it's a gamble every time you use it. Whereas the dedicated gloss coat, like gloss paints, are actually paint, like actual tested paints, especially the ones that are modeling based, like they're designed for models. So if you want to reduce risk and increase your chances of success, I do not recommend using future floor polish as a gloss. But that's up to you. You can if you want. But I'm just, like again, you want to increase your chance of success. And in my mind, the way to do that is to not introduce variables to your work. Now, what I'm doing here is everywhere I see that there's a decal that goes on here, I'm basically adding a little patch of gloss to where it's going to go. Now, some folks will say, well, doesn't that create a like a tonal error, because you can see that the color, you know, the paint has changed color. It hasn't changed color, it's actually changed its luster, which changes its tone. But no, it doesn't affect anything. I've been doing it this way for years and years and years. And once I spray this thing with a matte coat, all of these blend together. And after I spray it with the final gloss coat, all of these patches just disappear. So it is not something I'm concerned about because it just goes away. And now the reason I do this is because this is where how I learned to do it back in the 90s. This is the way everybody was doing it. And they were using the Future Floor Polish back then, which is why I was using it back then. You couldn't really buy, back then you couldn't really buy like a gloss paint and use it like this. Just didn't, it wasn't, you couldn't, you could probably buy it, but it wasn't meant for models. All right, that's this side. I can't let that sit on the table because it's wet. So back in the 90s and the 80s, when I was building sci-fi models, not armor. I've only been building armor for 10 years. No. Been 15 years. 15 years I've been building armor. And so I've been building sci-fi since 1982. And I've only been building armor since 2006. What's that, 15 years, I think? Something like that. But when I first started building sci-fi, I wasn't using anything. No gloss, no nothing. I was just licking stick the decals. I didn't know anything about them. And I didn't have access to magazines, or there was no such thing as the internet or YouTube back then. So I couldn't like look this stuff up. I was just a kid, so I didn't have any reference material or anything. I just bought the models and built them and went, yay, done. And I did that for years and years and years because I was just doing it for something to do. And then it wasn't until after I started building armor that I came back to building sci-fi and tried building them, you know, using proper techniques and methods and using research and proper materials and stuff like that. So it's actually armor modeling that brought me closer to sci-fi modeling, which I think is funny. So back then though, you know, when I first discovered that you had to put a gloss coat down under your decals in order to get your decals to sit properly, I was well acquainted with the effect of silvering and what happens when you don't put a gloss coat down, because all of my decals would silver. You know, I was following the instructions that the decals come with, and that's, you know, use warm water, and they suggested using gloss paint back then. Because that's what it suggested in some of the instructions, that use gloss paint to help with the decals. I tried doing that. It did help reduce the silvering, but it wasn't perfection. So it wasn't until I started using the Future Floor Polish on my decals that things started to improve. Oh, there it is. All right, so I'm nearly done with this. And once I finish adding the gloss, I have to wait a couple of hours for it to harden. And once it hardens, then I can put on the decals. That's the only slow part of this. The rest of the procedure is usually not very slow. Okay, so that's basically it for this part. So, again, you add your gloss to all the spots where all the decals are going to go, and then you let it sit and let it dry for a while. For aqua gloss, it's usually about 4 hours. I can wait. It depends on what I'm doing. For decals, I want to wait like at least 4 hours before I do anything else. But if I'm doing weathering, like oils or clay, sometimes I'll only wait like 2 hours. Sometimes only 20 minutes. I'll hit it with a hairdryer, dry it real quick. But hitting it with a hairdryer doesn't actually dry it. It gives it a skin. So it doesn't actually dry it. It's a bit of a deception there. Right, so I'll let that sit for a few hours, and then I'm going to come back, and then we'll actually start putting some decals on. So back in a bit. Right then, so I'm going to be doing the decals now. Everything's all gloss coated where I need it to be, and the gloss is dry. You may notice that the bug is maybe a little bit different than the last time. It's not just one color. It's because I realized that I had not filmed a segment of video on camouflage painting. So I used the bug as a test bed for camouflage painting in that video, which you've probably already seen if you're watching this entire series. The accuracy of the camouflage painting on the bug is something to be questioned. I can't really find any references that said that the Volkswagen actually had any camouflage on it, but I don't think it matters anymore, really. I don't even know if I'm going to use this on the diorama anymore, but if I do, it's going to be on the back anyway, so anyway. So what I'm going to do is, I've got everything all set up. I've got my hot water, I've got my cotton buds, I've got my decals ready, I've got a nice sharp hobby knife, I've got tweezers, and I've got a cocktail stick, and I've got setting solution, and I have a model that needs decals. What a coincidence. So for the bug, I don't need much. I only need these two decals here, these license plate. There we go. Now you can see it. These two decals here, the license plates. So the first thing I need to do is get them off of the paper. So I usually just cut them completely free. And since I'm never going to use that again, it goes in my stockpile of decals. And then I generally just trim enough of the decal like that so that there's something for me to hold on to without actually touching the decal itself. Now, you won't be able to see it on camera, I'm pretty sure, no matter how close I get it, because it won't focus. Of course not. Even though the autofocus is turned on. Well, either way, there is an edge, and there should be anyway. There usually is. I can't actually see it because I'm looking at the monitor, which is about 3 feet away, and I can't see the reflection in the angle that I'm looking at. There should be an edge on the side of the decal where the decal is separated from the rest of the film around it. If not, if you don't see that, that means you've got to cut it free. Now, I'm going to look to see myself. And I don't see one. Oh yeah, there is. Okay, I can see it. So it means that if I take this piece of paper that I've cut and I put it in the warm water, the white and a little tiny bit of carrier film around it should just lift off or become loose. I just want it to become loose. I don't want it to actually lift off. If it becomes lifted, if it lifts off, that's a problem. It makes it very difficult to recover the decal. You can. You just got to fish the decal back onto the paper and then gently lift the paper out of the water so that the decal is sitting back on top of the paper, and then take it over to your model and slide it off. So if your decal becomes separated from the paper, it's not the end of the world. You just got to get it back on the paper and then gently lift it out of the water. So if that happens, I'll demonstrate how to fix it, but I'm hoping it doesn't. So you put your decal in the water and let it sit. Usually it only takes a couple of seconds or so, but depends on the brand. Some brands it only takes a second or two, some brands it takes like 20 seconds or so. It depends on the quality. Better quality decals, it's faster. Poor quality decals, sometimes it's never. I've had decals where they never come off because they're just really shitty decals. So like I said, it depends on the kit manufacturer. So basically, how I test it, fish it out. So I'll take out the decal, and then I'll take a cotton bud and try and wiggle it. And if it wiggles, it's free. And this is free. So now, I usually take my super sharp tweezers, use them to hold the decal, and then I use my dull tweezers, a little bit of water from the decal onto the where the decal goes, so there's something for it to slide onto. So I'll use my dull tweezers. You can use the cotton bud or the cocktail stick, I should probably just demonstrate that, to pull the decal off the paper. Ta-da. Now, once it's on there, hello Murphy, my dog just came in to say hello. Once it's on there, use the cocktail stick or your tweezers, whichever, to get it into the perfect positions. Make sure it's on straight. Once it's there, cotton bud, a little bit of water, you gotta roll it on a piece of paper towel to get the excess water off, and then roll it across the decal gently so that it's nice and flat and you get the bubbles out that are trapped underneath it. Okay, then I don't touch it right away. I just let it sit there for a while, and usually I'll just go and do more of the decals, which is what I'm going to do now. So I'll take another one, stick it in there, and let it sit. Now, it didn't take that long. It only took a few seconds. Usually, I'll take a sip of tea or coffee. And fish it out. Sometimes it takes a lot longer than that. See if it's free. Yep, it's moving. Now, don't go crazy trying to wiggle it because you'll rip the decal. Ripping decals is not something you want to do. It's definitely something you need to avoid, because once you do it, there's no really difficult to fix it. All right, so this is an awkward spot to put a decal. So I'm putting some water on there. It'll help the decal slide, which is what you want. Now there's a handle this thing has to slide under. And what I'm doing now, yeah, I gotta be really gentle with it. You can get tweezers that are specifically designed to handle decals. They're kind of like tweezers with two big paddles on the end of it. I have a set, and if you notice, I'm not using them because I didn't find them particularly useful. Now that also might be because I never really practiced with them and never got very good at them. So I don't know. I guess I felt I wasted my money on them. But yeah, I've just decided I didn't really need them, so I never used them. I could do the same job with a pair of regular tweezers and or a cotton or a cocktail stick, and I didn't need to do anything other than that, so I chalked it up as, well, it was an experimental waste of money. So my dog is coming here to remind me that it's near lunchtime and he wants his food, which is why he's staring at me. I don't know if you guys can see him. He's staring at me. This is the Murphy, I'm hungry look, right? And that, in case you're wondering what that was a cyst that he decided that he needed to have a cyst just to make my life difficult. And through some very tender ministrations by myself, I managed to get rid of it. So he doesn't have to have surgery, which is something I'm very happy about, because giving my dog surgery is not something I care to explore. Anyway, that has nothing to do with modeling. So anyway, so I'm going to put some decal softener on here. This is decal setting solution, the Walther's Solvacet that I'd mentioned before. Now it comes with its own little applicator brush. You don't need a lot, just a little bit, and you just smooth it onto the decal. Do not put pressure. It acts fairly quickly, usually in a few minutes. You only need a little tiny bit. Sometimes you'll need several applications, but don't do several applications all at once. Put it on and then let it sit. Now, if the decal starts to wrinkle up a lot and starts to look like an old man's scrotum, good. You want that. You'd like to have old man scrotum, because that means the decal solution is doing its job. It will settle down. Don't panic. It'll be fine. Just let it do its job. When you come back like an hour or so later, the decal will be okay. Sometimes the decal just won't settle into the detail your first application, so you have to come back and you got to do it a couple of times. But don't give up. I mean, it just means your decal solution is not strong enough. It means you need to do several applications of it. Every application you do will do more and more and more. Sometimes you got to do four or five times. All depends on the texture of the surface that you're attempting to apply to, and it depends on the quality of the decal that you're using, and it depends on the strength of your decal setting solution. So they're all different. They all have different strengths, and they all have they're all basically the same chemical makeup. I really don't know. It says methoxy 2 propanol and methoxy 1 propanol. That's what it contains, but it doesn't say how much of it, and I really don't know what the fuck either of those things is. Some kind of hydrocarbon of some kind. I'll be fucked if I know. But yeah, I mean, for trade purposes, they don't tell you exactly what the chemical composition is, because then you could make it yourself, and what's the point of buying it, right? But I wouldn't mind figuring it out. I know people have used Tamiya Extra Thin as a decal setting solution. I've never tried that, and I absolutely do not recommend it, simply because I've never tried it, and I don't know what that would do. But you got to remember, Tamiya Extra Thin is not setting solution. It's glue. And it's really noxious glue. It's designed to melt, liquefy, actually, plastic. Decals primarily are set on plastic sheet. So adding Tamiya Extra Thin to them could do catastrophic damage to them. Or it could do nothing. I don't know. But the that's not what it's for. Tamiya Extra Thin is not meant for that. So I don't recommend doing that. I don't recommend using products for what they're not intended for, right? Building a base product from other essential ingredients, that's different. That's how everything gets created. Like, for example, making a clay wash. A clay wash, which I guess I'm going to explain at some point during this, clay wash is something you use for highlighting panel lines or doing weathering. So, but I'll explain what that is later on. But if you want to make one, they're simple things. It's just water, Maybe a drop or two of alcohol, depending on how you want the thing to work. A little bit of like dish soap or glycerol, and pastel chalks that you've ground up really, really, really finely. And you add them together, and you have a suspension with a dark or color material floating inside it that you can add to your model, and it creates specific effects. Now, it's easy to make those, but you can buy them as well. Now, the exact makeup of what's in your clay wash is what makes it either purchasable or it's garbage and you throw it away. So learning how to make one is how everything gets made. So I learned how to make a clay wash back in the late 90s, I think. And I never really did much of it. I mean, it was something I was using on sci-fi models. And then I got reintroduced to it again. I guess it was maybe 10 years ago. A little under 10 years ago, I guess. And I was using it again. I hadn't made the transfer into armor for that product yet. It never occurred to me to use it. But I knew that it had been. I mean, product history is something that I kind of pride myself on. But it just never occurred to me to do it. So I started doing it again, and, you know, I became very familiar with it. But learning how to make that product isn't misusing something for a different purpose. Like, you're not repurposing, like, future floor wax and repurposing it to make a gloss varnish, right? That's not something I recommend doing, because that's not what it's for. And there is a potential for making or for causing material contamination, like a reaction that you're unexpected, that an unexpected reaction that could destroy your model. So I don't recommend doing that kind of thing. Though there are decades of people using future floor wax as a successful varnish. But future floor wax has changed its chemical composition several times, and it's changed brands several times. So trying to find the right one can prove to be difficult. I would recommend finding a brand name, trusted, specific modeling varnish for that purpose. That way you know it's not going to fuck up on you. I don't use future floor wax for exactly that reason. I don't use it anymore because it reacted with some of the materials I was using, causing what looked like salt stains. It happened several times on several models, and it was very difficult to correct, and I never used it again. I stopped using it. I still have some, but I don't use it for anything anymore, really. It just sits in a bottle doing nothing. So, like I said, using materials that are specifically designed to do a specific thing is usually a better thing than repurposing something to do the same thing, if that makes any sense. The argument can be made, well, why can't I just use like pre-made oil washes or pre-made enamel washes to do my weathering? Why do I have to make them myself? Isn't that the same thing? No, it's not actually the same thing, because those pre-made enamel washes are made of the same materials you would use to make your own. So you're not repurposing, you're just recreating the same thing. You're actually making your own material using the same materials that the brand name ones are. So you'd essentially be like making your own future floor wax, or making your own Vallejo model air, if you knew how to do that, right? I mean, essentially that's what you would be doing. So and if you know how to do that, if you know how to make your own paint, fuck. That's something I wish I could do. I wish I had the manufacturing abilities to make my own paint. Holy fuck, that would be brilliant. So so I'm going to put on a couple of decals on here for anyone who's actually still paying any attention whatsoever, because probably not. Blizzard off. So this is the platform wagon. I'll just do like these three decals over here. Actually, I'll do them over here. It'll be easier for you to see. They're all basically, I think, the same on both sides of the thing. So the difficult part is finding them, because if you look, they're white decals on blue film or blue paper, so it's quite difficult to see, and I've got pretty intense light in here, so it's not an easy thing to find them. So I need one of these number sevens. I already know where it goes, so I'll just take it and plop it right in the water. It's going to go right there. And what's the next one? Number eight. Apparently number eight is this one. Goes right underneath it. You don't have to be super precise about removing the decal from the paper, as long as it's removed from the paper and you haven't cut through any of the other decals that are on the paper. So if you notice, it's, you know, not the straightest of lines, but as long as you haven't cut through the decal, that's all that really matters. Now let's see what the quality is of this decal. These are trumpeter. I think this is trumpeter. Don't want to use those tweezers. Those tweezers are really, really pointy. Nope, it's going to need more time. I can still see it working. Yeah, these are trumpeter decals. And they take more time for them to work their way off, which is kind of annoying. It slows things down. But the quality of trumpeter's decals are... the only deficiency is sometimes they're slow to take off the paper. The thickness and their ability to adhere are sufficient. Now I usually put a little bit of water. Now this decal has to conform around the corner on this. So it has a considerable detail that it needs to adhere to. Oh, someone at my door that I'm going to ignore. My dog's going to go batshit. It likes to let me know there's people there. He's a great doorbell and a great watchdog, but he's a terrible guard dog. Because what he wants to do is run outside and then lick their ears and jump on them, and then he wants them to scratch him and play with him. And that's kind of typical of poodles. It's probably just Amazon. I heard a rumor that there were some young girls walking around the neighborhood collecting recyclable bottles. So maybe it's them. I'll ignore them too because I'm busy. Alright, so I used a little bit of decal setting solution on that because I want it to start to conform right away. And this is the other one. This one goes right underneath it in that area there. I don't know how well you can see that. It's pretty dark. The thing about painting everything in dark gray, it makes it difficult to see anything. While I was manipulating that, I should have thrown that other decal in there. All right, I need number 18. There it is. Now, if you're doing decals on a subject that has a lot of decals, it's a really good idea to take a pen and start crossing off on here, like which ones you've already put on, because it can get very confusing and you'll start missing things. It's very easy to miss decals. And don't cut the numbers off with the decal, because sometimes they only put one number to mark off two decals. So if your vehicle has two sides like this, this vehicle has two sides, and the two sides are mirror images of each other. So what Trumpeter has done is they have one number to indicate two replicated decals. So there's this decal and then the decal I just cut off, they're identical, but they only have one number to indicate them. So don't cut the number off, just cut the decal off. That way you know this is also an 18. And like 17 is here, but this is a 17 and this is a 17. So only cut the decal off, leave the number behind. Plus, you don't want the number to come off the carrier film and end up on your model anyway. I've done that a couple of times. Okay. A little bit of water. Oh, shit. Dampen that. This is supposed to conform to the detail, like the one above it. Jerk is trying to pick it up without ripping it. There we go. This one's going to be a bit of a pain in the ass. The decal is pretty stiff, and the surface is really, really sharp. Makes it difficult for the decal to conform, so I'm going to need some setting solution to soften it. Straightest thing in the universe. And once you put your softening solution on, you don't want to touch the decal anymore, because the decal, once the solution is on it, is wicked delicate, like crazy, crazy soft, and you can rip it really, really easily. So don't put your decal setting solution on until you know the decal's where you want it to be. And if your setting solution comes with a brush, like a built-in brush like mine does, just be very, very gentle with using that brush so that you don't move your decal once it's on, so you don't that sucked. So don't move it out of position. You don't have to sit there wiggling and worrying your decal around with decal setting solution sitting on it. There's a good chance you're going to rip it. Alright, that was easy. That one was. Decals that have to conform over rounded surfaces, like domes and stuff, those are the hardest ones. I've never had much luck trying to get that. A good example, the roof of a Cromwell tank has a ventilator. It's like an armored rent ventilator. It's got a ring around it, like that, like a bullet shield. And then the ventilator cap sits inside. It's like a dome, right, that sits inside it. And, I mean, the real-life thing is only about that big, right? And then it's got an armored cap that sits inside. And it's on the roof of the turret. Actually, I'm showing you a picture of it now. That ventilator often has a big white star painted over it. It's bigger than the dome. So part of the star is painted over that dome. If you're modeling it, it means you have to put a decal over that. And every time I build a Cromwell, that one area is always a pain in the ass, because it's very difficult to get a decal to conform to that surface. And I've only had moderate luck in the past doing it. So what I've done is, there's a friend of mine and his wife, Lisa Wells and Nigel Wells. I got their card here somewhere. Here it is. These fellows, these wonderful folks here. Ta-da! Get it. There we go. They make masks for painting, and they make one specifically that works on the Cromwell. And So that's what I use in place of that star, because I can't get a decal to fit in there properly. So I started using the masks, and I gotta tell you, it made a big difference. The last time I did it, it was basically perfect. The mistakes that were made with it were mine, not the masks. It's because I was new to using masks, but I could see how it would be very easy for me to get better at it. Better than the decals, anyway. The decals, because they're printed on flat piece of paper, two-dimensional, they're not going to conform to a three-dimensional surface that has shape to it. I mean, it's not possible. But paint can. So if you mask it off and then spray it, it'll automatically, the paint just, it only goes to where you've masked or where you haven't masked. So it's better by far than a decal. So like for things like that, absolutely, I recommend using the masks. And Lisa has been quite diligent about making like shitloads of mask sets for a whole crap load of subjects. The vast majority is aircraft, because Nige is an aircraft modeler, and so he's the one that's able to provide the most reference material for her. But they also have some armor subjects, like German crosses and like the Balkenkreuz and stuff like that and everything, and Allied stars, like the Circle and stars and stuff like that and everything. So there's quite a few that are very, very useful for that. And I have a couple of them here that I have every intention of using over and over again until they wear out. They will wear out eventually, of course, because they're paint masks. But yeah, they're not very expensive either, so it's quite an affordable thing. A little bit of a shameless plug for a friend of mine and his wife, but I don't mind. They also sell model kits in case you're, and tools, modeling tools, diorama accessories, like where are they? I got them here. Yeah, I haven't used them yet, but bricks. Bricks, loose, standard loose bricks, just, you know, for diorama stuff and everything. So, yeah, you know, I recommend checking them out. There's a link to their website in my video description if you want to check it out. So anyway, that is essentially decaling, whatever the fuck it is. You're putting wet transfers on models. There you go. How's that? And there are a number that are going to go on here, and it's going to take me the rest of the afternoon to do this, I think. So I think that's what I'm going to do, and then I'll come back and I'll start talking about chipping. So that'll be the next bit. Right. Okay, so the decals are all on, they're all settled down, and I just finished sealing them with a little bit of aqua gloss, the gloss varnish, after I've added the decals. They're all on and in position, and the setting solution has settled them down, and I'm happy with how they look. I'll let them sit for a few hours, basically overnight, and then the next day I'll take a little bit of gloss varnish, whatever varnish you decide you want to use, and then I'll just seal where all the decals are, so that they're sandwiched between two layers of gloss varnish. It protects them, keeps them from being damaged by any kind of chemical additive that I plan to add later on, and the decals are basically impervious to damage. Yeah. So this video is already too long now for me to do chipping. My plan was to do a three-part, you know, decals, detail, and chipping. But that's not going to happen. So the next video is going to be on chipping. And so that's where we're going now. Anyway, you guys be good. Keep your stick on the ice. Bye for now. Okay.